So I want to share this morning about living this dynamic, spirit-filled life. And I often ask myself, what stops us from living this life? What stops us from entering into everything that God has? And I'm reminded a little bit as I started to question that in my heart. I remember a few times when I've done things and I've spoken things or I've said something over somebody's life. And I can remember two particular times. There was a young lady that she was very, very anxious about finding a husband and things like that. And one day on church, I just felt strong in my heart that God had prepared a guy for her. And there was a man that God had, and he was going to bring him along. And so I spoke this over her life, and I said, God's got somebody special for you. And so, you know, just rest in that. And after I spoke those words over her life, it looked like as if everything that I said was going to, you know what I mean? It didn't seem to happen in this a situation that arose that I'm not going to speak any further about, but it just looked like as if it was just nothing, you know what I mean? Like, and so what happened is as I spoke those words out in confidence and in boldness, and then as I started to see what I could see with my natural eyes, what happened in me was I started to lose confidence in what I said. And so I started to say, well, I'm not going to say that over, I'm not going to talk over people's lives. I don't care what I feel, I'm not going to say it. So what I'm saying is we shut ourselves down. There's another situation where the young man that we knew when we were living in America, and he was studying to be a pilot. And Nancy and I and him and his wife were having lunch together, and I said to him, sir, please, you know, you're getting all upset about not being able to get a job as a pilot, but I believe that God's going to put you in the ministry. I believe there's a call of God on your life for ministry. Again, after I said those words, all these other doors started opening up. He got a job as a pilot. He's flying planes everywhere. Neil, shut your mouth. Just be quiet, you know. Don't say these things because, you know. Anyhow, today he is working as a pastor in one of the largest churches in America today. And he has got an amazing gift of God on his life. Both he and his wife are working there. So what I'm saying is, now, what God, I believe, is wanting to do in all of our lives is restore again our confidence. That what God says to us that we can really grab hold of. And what stops us from entering in is our minds and our imaginations and our thinking, as we think that we've made a wrong decision. We think that we've done something that we shouldn't have done. But at the time, we really feel that God, this is what God said to do. Now, am I talking to the choir, or is anybody else like that in this place? You know, and that's where we've got to really hang in and say, no, I really believe that the decision that I've made was God. That was the right decision, the decision that God wanted me to make. And so we can build confidence again. Otherwise, next time God speaks to you, you're going to be hesitant. You're going to withdraw, and God can't take us to the place that he wants to take us to us. We're in the prayer meeting today, and we're just praying away there. And I believe I just had a thought in my mind, and here we go again, I'm going to say it, that God has got so much more that's available to us than what we're actually experiencing right now. You believe that today? There's so much more that God wants to take us into. And I don't want to be stuck in the mud. I don't want to be stranded here. I don't want to be anchored by perhaps even things that I haven't seen that I've put my hope in, that I put my faith in. And I believe that we're going to see some things happen. Do you believe that? So we're going to be talking about the dynamics of living a spirit-filled life. You know, I'm not talking about, receiving the baptism in the Holy Spirit. I'm not speaking about just talking in tongues, but living a spirit-filled life, knowing what God has made available to every believer. God has made so much available to every believer. I don't know about you, but guys, have you ever been to the refrigerator? You open up the door and you say to your wife, honey, where's the such and such? And she said, oh, it's in the fridge. So you go in there and you have a look. You go to the wardrobe and you got You can't find it. Anybody else like this here? And you say, it's not in the fridge. It's not here. They walk up to the fridge, open up the fridge, just pick it out, give it to you. Walk into the wardrobe. There it is there, right there. And you know what? There's so many things like that that are in the Word of God that are there all the time, but we just haven't been able to see it. And no, we don't need our wife to tell us, but we certainly need their Holy Ghost to show us. Amen. I don't need Google. I got Nancy. Yes, that's going to cost me, I know. But it was there all the time. Same with the promises of God. In Hebrews 11:6, God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. Do you believe that? Do you believe what the Word of God says? Hebrews 13:8, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Believe that. 2 Corinthians 1:20, the word of God is yea and amen. Isaiah 55:11, the Word of God will not return to Him void, but it will accomplish that which He's purposed it to accomplish. And Mark 16:17, it says, you shall lay hands on the sick and they will recover in the name of Jesus. You'll cast out demons. You'll do all these sort of things in that precious name. See, I believe that God has got so much for us, so much more for us, but it's a bit like you can look at the tap all day, but until you turn it on, you won't get water. Until you switch the switch, you won't get the power. Until we start to change in a particular way to believe God and believe His Word, we won't see the manifestation that God really wants us to show the world. I believe that God's going to use His church in an amazing way. The Bible says, you shall know the truth and the truth will make you free. We must know the truth. God is not a man that He should lie, neither the son of man that He should repent. Has He not said it? Will He not bring it to pass? These are all truths. John 16:7. Let's have a quick look at that scripture. John 16. I really believe that we need again to hear again the Word of God and see what He's got to say to us. It says here in verse 7, nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It's to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send Him to you. And when He comes, He will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment, of sin because they do not believe in Me, of righteousness because I go to the Father and you see Me no more, of judgment because the ruler of this world is judged. What an amazing scripture, amen. But Jesus said here, it's better for you if I go. Because if I do not go, I cannot send the Comforter. You know, a lot of people, this is proof that Jesus went back to heaven, amen? This is proof that He's not in some grave. There's a lot of people today that think that He just died and they buried Him. But this is proof because He said, when I go back, I'm going to send the mighty Holy Spirit. How many people are glad that the Holy Spirit has come, amen? He said, it's better for you if I go, because when I go, I'm going to send the mighty Holy Spirit. And He's going to lead you and guide you. He will speak truth to you. He'll tell you the truth. You shall know the truth. But it's better for you that if I go. This is a proof that Jesus made it back to heaven. He said, when I get back, I'll send the Holy Spirit, and He will, in John 14:26. But it says, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, who the Father will send in My name, He will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I've spoken to you. I want to tell you, we really need, again, the mighty power of the Holy Ghost to get around our lives. I spoke the other week, and I'm going to share a little bit again, but Ezekiel saw a river flowing from the throne of God. He said that this river flowed like it brought life wherever it went. Joel prophesied about it. In the last days, I will pour out My Spirit upon all flesh. The disciples experienced this river of life. The promise of this river that God said was out of your innermost being would flow rivers of living water. That's in John 7:37. or out of your innermost being. The promise was that the river would flow into you and through you. That, you know, I believe that the Spirit of God wants to flow through His church again. I believe that there's a move of God, that God wants to accelerate, if I can say it like that. He wants to do something. I was reading an article and I shared it at the prayer meeting this morning. You know, God never ever created a denomination. He created a kingdom, people. He created a kingdom. There's only one church, friends. There's one church, but there's many, many denominations. And this man had a dream, and he had a vision of something that happened, and all the churches, all of a sudden, it was like an earthquake, it was like something, a tornado, and things like that, just great things, but all these walls came tumbling down. The churches just started, everything started to happen. It was chaos. But out of this chaos, it says that a man started to come out of the rubble. And he stood at the top of the rubble, and it says that he began to preach the word of God. And as he began to preach the word of God, he burst into flames. What an amazing thing that is. He burst into flames. And as he burst into flames and as he began to preach, it came not from this one and from that one, but from all those different places. It came, people started to come out of the rubble, and they started to stand around the presence of God. Friend, I want to say there's one thing that's got to be smashed down, and that's our thought of that we are it. Or that this denomination is something. God has got one denomination. It's called the body of Christ. Hallelujah. Doesn't matter where you belong, where you come from, or that. If you believe in Jesus Christ, you are, hallelujah, part of that body. Amen. What an amazing thing that God would do these sort of things with people like you and me. Ezekiel saw this great river flowing from the throne of God, and different ones prophesied over it, and different ones spoke about it. What an amazing thing. In the last days, I'll pour out my spirit, and the disciples experienced this outpouring of the spirit. The purpose was that this river would flow into you and through you. Out of that innermost being would flow rivers and living water. The only difference between the Dead Sea and the Red Sea is that the Dead Sea does not have an outlet. I don't know if you've ever been to the Dead Sea, but you can't even swim in the Dead Sea properly. You can't get under it. You can only float in it. It's so salty. It's so there. But so are so many Christians that if we don't have an outlet, if we don't learn to have an outlet in our lives, well, I believe that that's the sort of thing that will happen to us. Let me just go back. I think that somebody blew my page over here. Word of God. We're pretty right. Ezekiel saw a river flowing from the throne of God. Joel prophesied about it. And the Bible says in the last days we'll pour out His Spirit upon all flesh. The baptism in the Holy Spirit sets you free in the spirit world. Acts 2, 1 and 4 is the account of this refreshing of the Spirit of God. It's the flow of freedom from man's born-again spirit. I believe what God wants to do is He wants to bring freedom and liberty back into the church. He wants us to be free. I forget, there was a word this morning, somebody spoke this morning about, can you remember what that was, Chris? About unashamedly, was that this morning or was I dreaming? Anyhow, it was something about that we would, there would be a freedom that we wouldn't be intimidated. That was undignified abandonment. That was the word. Was that you? Did you say? Good. Yeah, I knew somebody said it. Undignified abandonment. See, you find the disciples, that there they were in an upper room and the Spirit of God fell on them and something started to change in their lives. There was a freedom that came into their lives, a liberty that came into them that caused Peter to stand up and speak boldly, speak with that unashamedly, just something that was so dynamic and so powerful in his life that started to flow out of him. Because you see, we are the conduits, we are the channels that God wants to use. He wants to flow through us. That's the whole purpose of the Holy Spirit, that He could come through us and into us and flow out of us, that we would be that channel that God would be able to use. And it says in Acts 2:1-4, and this is the account of this release of the Spirit of God. It's the flow of freedom from man's reborn spirit. You are a spirit. And you live in a soul. You have a soul, but you live in a body. When Adam sinned, the Bible said, his light went out. The light of his spirit vanished. Life left him. And death came to him spiritually. The Bible says in Genesis 2:17, it says, the day you eat of the fruit, you shall surely die. So something happened, but also something happened. The Bible says in Ephesians 2:1, it says, but you he has made alive who are dead in trespasses and sins. Jesus spoke about being born of the Spirit. See, what we've got to understand is that the Holy Spirit wants to bring life. He wants to bring the presence of God into us that will cause us to rise up. Cause us to break through, to break through the barriers, break through the negative thoughts, break through whatever has got to be broken through. The Holy Spirit today is moving mightily, I believe. But you, He has made alive who are dead in your trespasses and sins. Jesus spoke about being born of the Spirit in John 3:5. He also spoke about being baptized in the Holy Spirit and being clothed with power in Acts 1:8. This is not some Pentecostal doctrine, but it's a Bible truth. It's not some thing that just Pentecostals want to speak about. Really, it is a command of God. It is a command of Jesus. Jesus said to his disciples, don't go anywhere until you've been endued with power from on high. A lot of people today are confused because of what we are taught. But in Acts 19:2, Paul met a group of people, and this is the words he said to them. He said, have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? And they said, sir, we have not even heard there is such a thing or such a one as the Holy Spirit. I believe that today we need to hear the truth and we need to hear what God wants to say to us by His Spirit, because God has got so much more that He wants to bring to our understanding and to whatever. It doesn't matter what you've done in the past or what you've seen in the past or what hasn't happened in the past. I want to tell you, God said in the last days, I'm going to pour out of my Spirit upon all flesh, and there are going to be signs and wonders and miracles. And God says that we're going to go and lay hands on the sick and that they will recover. We're going to cast out demons in and through His mighty name. And what we need to do is the source of that power is again to call upon the mighty name of Jesus and the mighty Holy Spirit, that He will flow through us and out to a world that really, really needs God. Amen. They don't need religion. People don't need religion today. We need a move of the Spirit, amen. We need to hear what the Spirit of God is saying. You is made alive. We need to release this power. Let's think again about Mark 16:17. And these signs will follow them that believe. Will follow. There's a follow. There's something that you and I really, really need to do. Is as we go. The Bible says that Jesus upbraided the disciples because their unbelief and their hardness of heart. And He spoke these words to him. He said, go ye into all the world and preach this gospel. Friend, can I say this? I believe that what we can, to encourage yourself in the Lord. Don't get stuck in the mud. Don't just sit around believing that you can't change. The more you speak, the more you share with one another. You get around and have a cup of coffee, start talking about the Holy Ghost. Start talking about the power of God. Start talking about the anointing. Start talking about the days of old. I had a talk with Ivan the other day. And this guy is Ivan's brother. He took up a bunch of tapes to him, CDs from here. And Ivan said, "I'm so excited, I couldn't sleep." And we started to talk, and as we began to talk and just share the things and the anointing and what God is doing, I was getting stirred up, amen. You just get excited about God. I can remember when we were over in the States there, and we were ministering with some churches. We met up with Andrew Ironside. And we were in a cafe there, and we started talking about the outpouring of the Spirit. We started to talk about the things of God, what God was doing. And I want to tell you, friend, there was something starting to happen. You were stirring yourself up. That's why I believe that Paul spoke to Timothy and said, Timothy, stir up the gifts that are inside you. Stir up the Holy Ghost. Stir up the what's all going on. Because I want to tell you, there's a channel inside of you that God wants to flow through. God wants you to go into all the world. It says that these people, after they were going through hell, but he upbraided them for the hardness of their heart and their unbelief. And he said, "Listen here, boys, pick up your skirts, get moving, go into all the world and preach this gospel." I can see that vision of that guy coming out of the rubble, standing on top of the rubble and starting to preach the word of God, and he burst into flame, hallelujah. I don't know about you, but you can start talking to people and sharing the things of God and something starts to burn on the inside of you. Who knows what I'm talking about today? You get stirred up, you get excited, and there's nothing like getting excited in Jesus, amen. Because I believe that God is about to do something great. He said, "These signs will follow them that believe in my name." And he said that they went. And as they went, God worked with them. Friend, I want to tell you what's going to cause the dynamic power of God to flow through you and flow through me, flow again through the church, to unclog that which has been clogged, is when we start doing what God says to do. When we go out and we start talking to people about Jesus, when we start believing, and when we see somebody in a need where we can lay hands on them and believe for the power of God to flow through them, amen. You know, I know myself, as I said before, when with the prophetic words and things like that and different things that you do and you don't see it happen the way you think it should happen, that we go back. Remember that scripture that says, you know, that we can drift away. We drift off course. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 4. That we just drift away. But I want to say that I believe that God is calling us back again. God is gathering a people again that we would go out there and do great things, I believe, in Jesus' name. How many people believe that today? You know, the anointing will break the yoke. The anointing will destroy every fetter. The anointing will do a great work. It's not a Pentecostal doctrine, but it's a Bible truth. It's something there that he spoke to those guys. He said, "Have you received?" They said, "We haven't even heard about it." He laid hands on them. They were filled with the Holy Spirit and the power of God. Do you know that those few people, there wasn't many of them, but they started to change the whole world that was around them. There was a great move of God. They say that in that particular time, there could have been up to 40,000 people in that gathering of people. Just because of a few men and a few women that started to go out and declare. Friend, if ever there's a day we need a fresh dose of the Ghost, it's today, amen. If ever, again, we sing these songs, "Lord, pour out your Spirit," we're asking you, Lord, to breathe on us again. Friend, these are not just songs. They're not just words that are, you know, that we're just saying. But I don't know about you, but I believe that as a bunch of people, that if we can get something on the inside of us that says, "God, would you breathe on me again? God, would you breathe on me again? God, would you pour out your spirit again on Australia? God, this great south land of the Holy Ghost, would you do something? Would you do something, my God, in your church that would cause us to rise again, that would cause us to shake off all the lethargy and all the junk and all the rubbish that the enemy's put on us, that would stop the work of the enemy, and Lord, we'd become wholly thine. Lord, that we would just be a voice for you in the wilderness today. Father, we know that the time is short. Oh God, would you raise your hands with me today? Lord, stir us again. Breathe on us again. Can you cry out to God? Can you cry out to God? Hallelujah. Breathe on us. Breathe on us, mighty Holy Spirit. Oh, it's a command. Don't leave Jerusalem until you receive the power of the Holy Ghost. We need to receive this power, that it would flow through us, that it would flow through us. Jesus wants to open up the supernatural manifestations, amen, to the church. Amen. He wants to open up the supernatural manifestations to the church, that we would be demonstrators of his power. Wouldn't be just talking about it. Next Saturday and Sunday, you will see people healed in Jesus' name. You will see miracles. I know that. Because this man has found a key. He is bold. He is strong. I want to catch that. As a church, I want us to catch something. I want you to watch him like a hawk. I want you to watch him and see that is when somebody comes up in a wheelchair, he doesn't go, he's, shakabundi. That he goes in there after it, amen. Jesus demonstrated God's power that was in him. Acts 10:38 says how God anointed Jesus with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went around doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil. For God was with him. God wants to demonstrate his power through his church. And Jesus came as our example. He turned water into wine. He fed 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fishes. A boy's lunch. He raised the dead. He healed the sick. He walked on water. He was there demonstrating the power of God. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. We've got to somehow or other say how God has anointed the church with the Holy Spirit and with power, and wants us to go around doing good, healing all who are oppressed of the devil. Friend, we've made church into some sort of a social club where we come and sit and we listen and we have a little time together and then we go out and then we come back again next Sunday. But friend, I want to tell you that God wants to stir us. He wants to put a burr in our undies. He wants to get us up off our blessed assurance. He wants us to know and realize that he has got a purpose and a plan for the church, and that is to go into all the world and to preach the gospel. We are carriers of the dynamic power of God, and God wants you and I to demonstrate his power. Hallelujah. Just doesn't want us to have a bumper sticker on the back of our car. Honk if you love Jesus. We're not geese. Jesus demonstrated the power of God, and he wants you and I to demonstrate the power of God. Jesus raised the dead, he healed the sick, he turned water into wine. He did amazing things, but he walked on water. He came to his disciples walking on water. And I want to tell you, friends, if God could give us a boldness and a tenacity on the inside, that we would dare to put our trust in God and dare to say, God, I want what you've got. And there was a man in the boat as Jesus walked by, as he looked at him, they were full of fear. But he said, don't fear, it is I. And Jesus, and Peter looked at him and said, if it's you, he said, bid me come. Bid me come. And Peter gets out of the boat. You know, friend, I want to tell you this. We've got a wrong concept of God. We've got to understand that God says, freely have I given, freely receive, freely give. Amen. God wants you and I to be these channels that He can flow through. And Peter, as he said, I want to walk on water. You know, if that was not in the way, in the heart of God, if that wasn't in the heart of Jesus, Jesus would have looked at him and said, who do you think you are? You're nothing but an upstart. I've had that said before. Who, don't you know who I am? I am the Son of God. I can do these things, but who do you think you are? What gives you the right to even ask me? And Peter would have said, because you said, these things that I do, you can do also. He didn't say, I honestly believe that when Jesus was walking on the water, and as he came up, he first of all saw the fear in him. He said, don't fear, it is I. And then this Peter stood up and said, if it's you, bid me come. I bet you Jesus, I've seen those tennis players, but the cricket players, but I believe Jesus would have gone, yes, yes, yes. Yes, by Jove's, I think they're getting it. Yes, yes, yes. You see, I believe when you stand there, and honestly, I'm not saying, let's not just sing a song. Let's not just do another thing. But when we're saying, breathe on me, let there's something from the innermost part of your heart go reaching out and say, God, touch me. Touch me. Breathe on me. There's got to come that, I believe, a cry that will touch heaven and people will respond to that. I believe that there's a move of God. Peter said, I want to walk on water too. Yes, come. Jesus would have been delighted when he said to Peter, come. Peter walked on the water that day. I think somebody's getting it. I believe as a people, as a church, I honestly believe that we have to step out of our boat of unbelief and fear and dare to believe and speak to the mountains. Cast every negative thought out of our minds. And lay hold of God. If we're going to see a change in 2017, if 2017 is going to be a year . How many people want to see the Sunshine Coast change for Jesus? Jesus, the same yesterday, today, and forever. But I don't want to stay the same. I want to change. I want to go deeper. I want to go further. I know it's not by might, it's not by power, but I know it's by the Spirit of God. I believe. Jesus is standing outside the boat, saying, will you get out of the boat? Will you get out of the boat? Will you get rid of the negative thoughts? Will you get rid of the negative feelings? Will you get rid of whatever we've got to get rid of? Can we step in to the supernatural, the dynamic power of living a Spirit-filled life? Believe God. Believe God. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. and lean not to your own understanding, but in every way acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. To believe that he said, you shall lay hands on the sick and they will recover. Believe that he said, you will be endured with power from on high. Believe that he says that no weapon formed against you can prosper. Believe, only believe. Friend, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. There is something I believe that God has installed. Linda had a time, and I've read some of the things that you wrote as God was speaking to you about the music team and about the worship team. And as I was reading those things, I believe the Spirit of God spoke to me. Can you just come up here for a second? Can you remember any of that which you... Just come and just share it.
I just wrote a couple of weeks ago, driving to worship practice, I was praying and got the words breakthrough year for the worship team and the scripture Ephesians 1:19. And so you will begin to know what the immeasurable and unlimited and surpassing greatness of his active spiritual power is to us who believe. These are in accordance with the working of his mighty strength, which he produced in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his own right hand. And then on Wednesday night, Jody was talking about the song Victor's Crown that Nancy gave her. It's not a new song, but it's a really powerful song. And it sort of confirmed it to me, that word about Ephesians 1:19. So then That's why I shared it on there. And then I was praying yesterday for a word for the team, and then I got this word: as you flow with the Holy Spirit, the angels sing with you and walls come tumbling down in people's lives. Never underestimate what I do on a Sunday through the power of the Holy Spirit. The Global Connections worship team has the authority and the capacity to tear down and build up and go forth in the Spirit in mighty power. Let the things of the world drop off your mind and heart as you begin to worship. Focus on my power, my anointing, and the Holy Spirit as your guide. And then I got the scripture, Psalm 24:7-9, which is all about the gates being lifted up and the King of Glory being able to come in. Who is the King of Glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. The Lord, mighty in battle. I tear down and I raise up. Come on, mighty army of worshippers. But I felt like the Lord was talking to the whole church with that bit there. Traverse the heavens with me. And I thought that was pretty cool too. Traverse the heavens.
So, Amen. So. Well, that's when what you just said then was, when you're talking about the music team, I felt that the church, we are the music team. Right, when God wants to tear down, God wants to tear down some stuff, because as we worship, worship isn't just singing a song. Worship really is when you're just in your prayer time or wherever it is, and you're just loving on Jesus and believing God. You know what I mean? It's worship. It's just lifting up your heart to God. God wants to do things. I believe that in our heart, God wants to turn negatives into positives. God wants to change some things. And there was a gentleman that a lot of people in this church will know, and I'm not going to mention his name. But he was a great sports person on the Sunshine Coast. But he was an alcoholic. And as an alcoholic, he was very, very angry, very, very terrible man to live with. Many times the wife would ring us, and sometimes the children and the wife would come to our house to hide from him. Sometimes they hid under a table. Sometimes he'd smash the house up. He did horrible things. But what I'm saying is that we can't be moved by what we see. We've got to be moved by the power of God. And when you're in a move of God, when there's something happening, you can put your faith and you can put your trust in God. And this little mother and a few people that were around her kept praying. This man got gloriously saved. He got totally transformed by the power of God. He became one that led most surely hundreds and hundreds, and still is most surely many, many people through his music, through his singing, through different parts of his life. The Holy Spirit. What I'm trying to say is, friend, it doesn't matter what we see today. It doesn't matter what we see in the natural, but what we do, we've got to see in the realm of the Spirit. And we've got to be able to believe, and we've got to turn negatives into positives. And we've got to be able to put our trust in God again. Amen. If we're going to see 2017 change, the thing that's going to change is us. We've got to, you know what I'm saying here today? I'm just saying that we've got to, lift our game. When we're worshiping, when we're singing, that those songs, Holy Spirit, we can just sing a song, but we can become a prayer.